Welcome to South Point Church Online. I want to say hi to our Southern Maryland community. We're so glad that you're with us. I also want to welcome those of you that might be watching from different parts of the country or maybe even different parts of the world. My name is Matt. I'm part of the team here at South Point. And on behalf of our amazing volunteers and our amazing staff, we're so glad that you chose to watch with us. And so, hey, listen, I'm really excited. We're kicking off a brand new series called God of the Underdogs. And here's why I'm excited about this series is because this series applies to everyone. And here's what I mean. It doesn't matter whether you're watching and you have no faith, or you're viewing this and you have different faith, or you've been a follower of Jesus for a really long time. At some point in our lives, each and every single one of us will be an underdog. And so this morning, as we kick this off, what I want to do is give you kind of the main idea behind this whole series that each and every one of us will face. And I'm going to put it up here on the screen, and it's this. Every one of us will face times when the odds are against us and losing seems certain. I don't know if you want to put a little wave or a little amen in the chat, but I bet that all of us can think of a time, and maybe now's that time, but all of us can think of a time when the odds were against us and losing seemed certain. As I was preparing for this and I began to think about the times that I faced overwhelming odds or it was certain that I was going to lose, there were a ton to pick from, way more than I ever wanted to. But for me, one of my most significant moments where the odds were overwhelming and I felt like losing was a certainty happened in a jail cell when I was 15 years old. Now, I need to give you a little bit of background. I grew up in somewhat of a dysfunctional family that was broken. My mom had been married twice and divorced twice. She took her own life when I was 9. I went to go live with my biological dad and my stepmom when I was 12. I got taken to the police station and was incarcerated at 12 and a half. I spent over 2.5 years in the juvenile justice system in this one institute and eventually got kicked out, well, for being bad and crazy. This moment where I felt overwhelmed and losing with certainty was in that cell as I was awaiting my time with the judge. You see, before meeting with the judge, my probation officer had met with me and said, hey, we've tried our best. You're crazy. We're just going to recommend that you're incarcerated till you're 18 or 21 if necessary. My dad was with him and said, yep, we're just going to throw the book at you. I never saw my attorney till about an hour before my actual time before the judge, and I didn't feel very confident in him. And I can remember the sense that the odds were against me and that losing was a certainty. And I can remember that moment that I walked into the courtroom with a judge. I mean, you have to understand, I was 15. I had shackles on my hands. I had a waist chain and shackles all the way down to my feet. And I remember walking into the courtroom, and there was my probation officer and my biological dad on one side. And when I walked in, they just kind of looked at me and gave me that look of like, well, you're going to get what you deserve. And on the other side, there was this little table with a court-appointed attorney who looked too young to know what he was doing and was shuffling through the file like I was just a number. And as I sat down in that seat, I said, my life is over. They're going to lock me up and throw the key away. And then something happened in the middle of this courtroom session with this judge that I never expected to happen. As they were telling the judge all these bad and crazy things that I'd done, and believe me, I earned it. I had done a lot of bad and crazy things. But in the middle of them telling the judge all these things, the judge turned and looked at him and said, well, I see in his file that he has some psychological problems and that all the psych tests said that he's supposed to get this therapeutic counseling, and I don't see where he's getting that. And all of a sudden, my dad and my probation officer looked flustered, and they're like, well, yeah, the place we sent them didn't have that. And all of a sudden, the judge stopped them in their tracks and said, you need to get this kid some help. And this is the end of the story. Put him in the right place. I don't want to hear excuses. Hit his hammer. And my court-appointed attorney had this look on his face, and I had this look on my face. I had no idea that something miraculous had happened. Instead of my life being ruined, I had a second chance. And in that moment, when the odds were overwhelming and losing seemed certain, the God that I didn't trust and the God that I surely didn't follow showed up in that very moment, because I believe God is a God of the underdogs. And it got me thinking, I bet each and every one of us has faced overwhelming odds, or we have experienced a time where we feel like losing is certain. And what I've discovered, and I bet you've discovered, about facing overwhelming odds or the certainty of losing is it usually boils down to about three things in almost every area. And we're gonna put those up on the screen for us, and it's this. There's a label we can't overcome. Maybe for you, you got the label when you were in middle school or high school. Like there was a mistake, there was an accident, you like slipped in the lunchroom or something happened in the field of play or at a party, and you just couldn't shake the name and the label that people gave you. Maybe for you, it was in your job or your career. You just didn't get it right. You got it wrong, either by accident or by choice, and you can't get rid of the stigma even though you've changed jobs. Maybe it's in your community. You made a moral failure. You knew it was wrong. I knew it was wrong. Everyone knew it was wrong, and yet we chose to do it, and you can't seem to lose the reputation you gained. I bet all of us have had a label we can't overcome. The second one is there's a weakness we can't beat. And I put into three categories. The first one I call is a quirk. For me, I have one of these quirks. It's that my mouth moves faster than my brain can think. True story, I have this good friend, and one time they did something and they said, I can't believe I'm such a jerk. And before I could think, here's what I said. I go, oh, you're not a jerk. That's just you being you. Sometimes we have a weakness that's a quirk that we just don't notice and can't seem to fix. Sometimes we'll have habits. Maybe it's when worry or stress or pain comes in, we turn to food and overeating. Maybe when there's pain or worry and stress, we have the habit of turning to alcoholism. Maybe when there's worry, stress, or pain, we have the habit of spending money that we don't have or really should go to other areas. If we're honest, maybe when we experience pain or worry or stress, we turn to an illicit relationship or to pornography, and we have a habit that we can't beat. Maybe it's a dysfunction. Maybe something happened in our childhood and it was no fault of our own. Maybe there was some trauma we experienced as an adult and we can't seem to get past it. And every time we face a situation that's very similar to that, we have this dysfunction that causes ourselves pain and other people's pain. And so maybe there's a weakness we just can't seem to beat. And then the third one is there's a circumstance that we can't control. Now, maybe if you go, oh, I don't have a label or I can't see my weakness, I promise you we all have one, but I bet we're all in this boat now, right? That there's a circumstance that we can't control. I mean, we're in the middle of a global pandemic, right? The economy is in turmoil. We're in a political battle, right? And there's racial discord. And on top of all the craziness that's going on in the world on the outside, right? For many of us watching this today, when school starts, our kids are gonna be home with us doing digital education. I mean, our circumstances are so much right now, we feel like probably screaming and pulling our hair out. And the reality is whether you have no faith today or you have different faith today or you've been a follower of Jesus, these things aren't Christian issues or non-Christian issues. They are human issues that all of us will face. And it leads us to a truth that we've all experienced. You have already experienced this. So we're going to put it up on the screen. And it's this. We respond to the overwhelming by settling for the mediocre and seeking to medicate our pain. If we're really honest, our response to when the odds are overwhelming and losing seems certain is not usually positive. We usually settle for the mediocre, right? We see that losing hurts and isn't good. So we said, why try? Why shoot for something we may lose? Maybe we should just settle for what is easy. Maybe we should just settle for what is comfortable. Let's not shoot for anything that might cause us to fail. And we settle for the mediocre. If we're gonna lose, we might as well feel good while we're losing. And so we'll seek to medicate our pain. And here's the truth. Like, listen, I'm not telling you something that you don't know, right? You already know this, that when you and I settle for mediocre, when you and I seek to medicate the pain in our lives, we never end up with the life that we want or the life that we were meant for. And listen, no one wants that, right? And I'm going to tell you something else that you already know. Like, listen, there's something worse than settling for mediocre. Listen, there's a deeper pain than the agony of defeat. You know what it is? It is the regret of doing nothing. And you know this too, that when we medicate our pain, it may feel good in the moment, but the bad consequences are long lasting. And it leaves you and I asking this question because it's not an if question, it's a when question. All of us at some point will be an underdog in our life where the odds are overwhelming and losing is certain. And it leaves you and I asking this question today. How do we respond differently? How do we not settle for the mediocre? How do we not medicate our pain? How do we respond differently when the odds are against us and losing seems certain? You see, for us to experience the life that we want, for us to experience the life that we're meant for, we have to have an option. We have to have an answer to this question other than settling for the mediocre or medicating our pain. And this is where I get to share some awesome news with you as you watch. Listen, God knew that this would be an issue for every single person in the world in every generation. God knew this would be a problem. Matter of fact, this is just one of the many reasons that I love the Bible, because the Bible doesn't hide the flaws and failures of those who followed him. Matter of fact, Jesus addresses this very issue with one of his closest friends and his disciples. His name is Peter. Matter of fact, Peter addresses or had the same three problems that I just went over. Peter had a label, Peter had a weakness, and Peter had a circumstance. And so what I want to do today is look at these things so that we can see here was this person, this close friend of Jesus, this disciple of Jesus, and he had the exact same problems that we did. Matter of fact, I'm going to put up on the screen, Peter, he had a label, and you're kind of probably thinking, even if you don't have any kind of Bible background, you might go, I didn't know like the apostle Peter or the disciple Peter, he had a label. Yeah, we actually see this in the eyewitness account in the book of Acts. Now, Luke was a physician. He was an eyewitness and he recorded this in a letter to a group of people. And we're going to see it in Acts. And here's the label that Peter had. It says this in Acts 4:13. It says, when they saw the courage of Peter and John, they realized they were unschooled. And what's that word? Maybe you just want to type that in the chat. Ordinary. They were unschooled, ordinary men. You see, Peter had a label early on in life. You see, in the first century world that Peter lived in, his culture, that you wouldn't get education if you weren't deemed worthy enough, you would have to go into a trade. And we can see that even in his older age, he was still carrying the label of unschooled and ordinary. But listen, that's not the end. It says, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. And here is great news today, is that Jesus can get rid of whatever label the world gives to us. But I want you to know, just like there's a label, if you can't overcome, Peter had a label, ordinary. Ordinary and unschooled was a label that the world had given him. And you know what? Peter also had a weakness. We're going to go to the next slide. It says this. He had a weakness. Now, some of you might not have grown up in church. Some of you might be just joining us for the first time, right? And you know a little bit about Peter. He was in the picture of the last summer, right? But if you've ever read the Bible, Peter had this habit, a lot like mine. He was always sticking his foot in his mouth. His mouth moves faster than his brain. Matter of fact, there's a bunch of different encounters in the Bible where Peter just doesn't get it right. Matter of fact, one time, Peter's mouth moves faster than his brain so bad that Jesus actually says, you're like the devil. Like Jesus had just in a moment of vulnerability told his crew, his disciples, that he was the Messiah and that the way that God would change the world wasn't through power of force, but through the power of love, and that Jesus was the Messiah that was going to die sacrificially on a cross to redeem everyone, to redeem you, to redeem me. And Jesus tells everyone this. And then listen to what Peter does. Peter pulls Jesus off to his side and tells him he's wrong. Matter of fact, we actually see this in Mark 8. We're going to put it up on the screen. Listen to this. It says, Jesus turned around and looked at his disciples. So Peter like pulls Jesus' eyes and says, yeah, I know you're the Messiah. Like I've seen you do all these miracles, but no, I don't think that's God's plan for you. I know you're God's son, but like you shouldn't do that. And so in the middle of that, like Jesus turns and looks at the disciples and then listen to this. It says, then he reprimanded people and says, get away from me. And then he calls him the devil. Get away from me, Satan. He said, you are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. Just another example of Peter's weakness of sticking his foot in his mouth. So Peter had a label. I'm gonna put it up on the screen. He had a weakness. And he had a circumstance that he couldn't control. You see, I don't know if you've ever seen the painting of the Last Supper, but Jesus had this time. It was the meal right before he was going to go to the cross. And Jesus had kind of a hard message to tell his followers. He said, listen, you guys are all going to kind of abandon me. And one of you is going to betray me. And again, Peter's mouth is working faster than his brain. He says, not me, Jesus. I'm going to stay with you to the end. And Jesus simply reminds Peter, he says, not only will you abandon me, Peter, but you're going to deny me three times. And Peter's like, not me, not me. I would never do that, right? And then, so what happens? On the night that the soldiers come to pick Jesus up in the Garden of Gethsemane, Peter and all the disciples flee. And Peter's following behind along with all the soldiers to see where Jesus is getting tried. And somebody asks him, well, aren't you one of the disciples? And just like Jesus had said, Peter denies Jesus three times. Jesus is crucified and he's buried in a borrowed tomb. And Peter is facing a circumstance he can't fix. He abandoned his friend and he denied his friend. And now his friend was dead. And it was a circumstance beyond his control. And we can see how that led to the life that he didn't want and the life that none of us would want. We see this in John. We're going to put it up on the screen and it's right here. It says, Simon Peter said, I'm going fishing. You see, when the odds feel overwhelming, when we feel like losing is certain, we never actually move forward. We usually do what Peter did. I'm going to go back to my old ways. I'm going to go back to what is familiar. I'm going to go back to what is comfortable. And the rest of the disciples who had also abandoned Jesus says, we'll come too, they all said. So they went out into the boat and listen to what happened. They caught nothing. You see, when we settle for mediocre, when we seek to medicate, we end up with the life that we don't want. We don't end up with what we're meant for. We end up with something we were never meant to have. Now here's the amazing news. Here's the good news of Jesus. And listen, if you're new or if you're watching and you really haven't been engaged in church, I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking about an organization. I'm talking about a relationship with Jesus. Here's what's so amazing about Jesus. Despite Peter's, I mean, Peter had some epic failures. I mean, Peter had some epic flaws. But despite Peter's flaws and failures, Jesus picked Peter to be the leader of this Jesus movement that was meant to bring the kingdom of God from heaven to earth. You see, the church isn't a building. The church is an organization. The church is a group of followers of Jesus who bring up there, down here. And Jesus handpicked Peter, despite his flaws and despite his failures, to lead this. And you're probably thinking, are you sure about that? Well, here's Jesus' own words. We're going to pick it up and it says, and I tell you, Peter, and on this rock, I will build my church and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. You know, the interesting play on words is rock and Peter. And the word in the Greek word, Peter actually means pebble. And the truth that Jesus is the Messiah who would do through love on the cross and bring a power that could transform our lives, that foundational truth would be life-changing. And it leads us to something so amazing. It leads us to a truth that I just want to share with you this morning. If you feel overwhelmed and losing is certain, here's what I want to tell you this morning. We're going to put it on the screen. It's this. Our destiny isn't about how good we are. I mean, you should be fired up right now. You should be excited. Our destiny isn't about how good we are. It's about how good God is. And I want to encourage you, maybe, to pray that God would open your eyes and your ears and your heart. It wasn't until a little bit later as I look back on that moment in that courtroom, that the God that I wasn't following and the God that I didn't trust showed up in a moment that I didn't deserve, not because I'm good or I deserved it, but because He's good. Why would God do that? Why is God like that? How does this happen? How do we experience this in our own lives? Well, this morning, I want to share three brief truths. And here's the reason we'll need to know these three truths. Because if we don't know these three truths, we will settle for the mediocre and we will seek to medicate our lives. And so here's truth number one that I want to share with you this morning. God is for you. God is for you even when the odds are against you. I can't tell you the number of people that when they talk to me, they go, Matt, I don't believe in God. And I go, well, why don't you believe in God? Well, this bad thing happened to me. And if there was a good God, then bad things wouldn't happen. And at South Point, we have this little saying, and it goes something like this. Circumstances aren't the measure of God's love. The cross is. You see, here's what I believe. Bad circumstances and things that happen to us are evidence that we're broken and we live in a broken world. The cross is evidence that God left heaven and came and paid the ultimate price because He loves us. That our circumstances aren't the evidence. It's not the measure of how much God loves us. The cross is the amount of pain and suffering Jesus was willing to go through for you and for me and for we. And so this morning, you might be in a situation. Maybe you have a label that you can't overcome. Maybe you have a weakness you can't beat. Maybe you're in the middle of a circumstance that you can't control. Maybe you have all three going on. I want you to know, if you're watching this morning, that God is for you. Even when the odds are against you, there is a God who's a God of the underdog. And there's a second truth we need to believe, and it's this. God sees you as you can be, not as you are. I have two daughters. They're both college age now, but I remember when they were teenagers. And I remember this one time that we were sitting at the dinner table, and one of my habits was to try to be home a certain number of nights during the week to have dinner with my family, to engage and ask questions. And I could tell that one of my daughters was having like a tough day. And so I was encouraging her and I was giving her compliments and I was highlighting her strengths and her talents and the things that she was good at. And she looked at me and she said these words. She says, "You have to say that, Dad, because you're my dad." And I wanted to say, my dad never did those things to me. And some dads never say that. And the truth is, I don't have to say that. I see these things in you that you can't see in yourself. And here's the good news of the gospel. God doesn't see your past as something that keeps you from your future. You see, there's no sin, there's no problem, there's nothing that the blood of Jesus can't forgive. You see, when God looks at you, He doesn't see your flaws and failures. He sees you as a son or daughter of the Most High. All people are made in the image of God. See, God sees you as you can be, not as you are. Listen, none of us can go back and undo the chapters that are already written. But we can absolutely invite God to help us write what the future will look like, because God sees us as we can be, not as we are. And then lastly, here's a third truth, and this one is the most important. God paid the ultimate price for your destiny. You see, there's a God who's for you. We have a saying at South Point that goes something like this: anyone that would die for you is for you. God is not only for you, God sees you right where you're at. And He sees you not as you are, but as you can be. And God didn't just stop at being for you. God didn't just stop at seeing you. God paid the ultimate price. He sent His Son. As they nailed on the cross, He said, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they do." And on the cross, He yelled out, "It is finished." And the same power that rose Christ from the dead is available to transform our lives. God paid the ultimate price so that we could experience the life that we were meant for. And so I want to bring us to the next slide, and it's this right here. It's the reason Jesus is a big deal. This is core value number one at South Point. Jesus is a big deal. It's because life change is possible because God gave his best for us. See, this is the core of everything that is South Point. Listen, when you feel like you're an underdog and the odds are overwhelming and losing seems certain, Jesus is a big deal because life change is possible because God gave his best for us. God is for you. God sees you, and God paid the ultimate price. If I was going to sum up in kind of one sentence what I wanted to say in our time together as you watch this, I would say it this way. Our status, our strength, and our situations do not have to determine our destiny. You know, for some of us, we believe the situation that we are born in, maybe it's a socioeconomic thing. Maybe it's a race thing. Maybe it's a gender thing. Maybe we grew up in a dysfunctional home or we had a lack of education and we feel like our status will never allow us to fulfill the destiny that we were meant for. Maybe we have a weakness. Maybe we're going, if I was just smarter, if I was just stronger, if I just had more talent. Or this thing happened to me. Maybe it was a tragedy. Maybe it was a mistake. Maybe it wasn't even your fault. But for some reason, we often believe it's our status, our strength, and our situations that will determine our destiny. And what I want to share with you just simply as you watch this is it's not our status, our strength, our situations. They don't have to determine our destiny. And you're probably asking a really good question in this moment. Well, then what will define our destiny? And the answer to that is so simple. I'm going to put it up here. It's our trust and obedience to God that creates our destiny. You see, when we believe it's our status, our strength, and our situations, we'll settle for the mediocre or we'll medicate our pain when we face overwhelming odds or the certainty of loss. And the reality is, none of us win 100% of the time. And the reality is all of us will face overwhelming odds that we can't overcome in our own power and our own ability. And so here's what I've discovered. Our destiny isn't based on those things. It's based on our trust and obedience that God does. And so here's my challenge to us, is let's not settle for the mediocre. Let's not seek to medicate our lives. What if we stand on the character of Jesus so that we can experience the life that we want and the life that we were meant for? You know, as we come to a close, you might be thinking this. You might be going, Matt, that's easy for you. Look at you. You're a pastor. And I want to tell you, God stepped into that moment, but it was decades of small little steps that created the change in my life. Matter of fact, when I was younger, in all those years that I was in the juvenile justice system, there was a phrase that got repeated to me over and over by the professionals that worked in the system. So I need you to understand the gravity of the statement that I'm about to make. These are professionals who had working in the correctional facility on that was their career, right? I got told multiple times in multiple institutions and detention centers this exact phrase, Matt, if you don't change, you won't live to see 18. And if you happen to live to see 18, you won't see it outside the walls of a prison. The odds were overwhelming and loss or losing seemed certain. But there's a God who's a God of the underdog. And there's a God who will step into your life when the odds are overwhelming and losing seems certain. He is for you. He sees you and he paid the price. And you might be asking, what step can I take? What can I do practically? And that's a great question. And matter of fact, over the next several weeks, we're going to answer that question. So the only step that I'm going to give you today is to come back and watch next week as we continue our series called God of the Underdogs. Let me pray for us right now. Hey, God. Thank you. Thank you that you love us so much, that you are for us, that love compelled you to leave heaven, to walk in a busted and broken world, and to ultimately pay my price and your price and our price for all of our bustedness and brokenness. God, would you give us eyes to see the truth? Would you give us ears that are able to hear the truth and a heart that is willing to surrender? God, that we would believe those three truths and we begin to look for where you are stepping in. God, that we could, in a daily way, trust and stand on the character of Jesus. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. And never forget, you matter deeply to God.